very happy to see all of you here tonight. I mean, that's right, exactly. That's the biggest applause. You know, the weather the way it is, I'm going to be perfectly honest with you. I seriously contemplated not coming this evening. I said to myself, for sure they're going to have it online. I'll watch it later. But then I thought about it. I said, no, in person is always better. So I'm really happy to be here with all of you. So the title of the lecture tonight is Insults and Responses, Being the Bigger Person. I don't know whether you want to hear about being the bigger person or you'd rather hear some good insults or some good responses, but we'll try and cover a lot of ground. You know, some say that before you insult anyone, you should walk a mile in their shoes. Personally, I think the logic is that if after that you still decide to insult them, first of all, you're a mile away from them, and secondly, you have their shoes. The Gemara, actually several Gemarot, there are three Gemarot that speak about this, and Rashi quotes them all, says, Noah lo le'adam she'yapil asmo le'chibshan ha'esh. It is better for a man to throw himself, that would include a woman, throw himself into a fiery furnace. Now this has to be pretty big. For a person who is alive and knows what they're doing, to throw themselves into a fiery furnace and, God forbid, be consumed alive. I mean, who on earth would ever want such a thing to happen? The Gemara tells us it is better, Noah lo le'adam she'apil asmo le'chibshan ha'esh. It's better for a person to throw himself into a fiery furnace. Ve'al yalbin pene habero berabim. And not embarrass another person in public. That sounds very dramatic. How do we understand that? Wait a minute. What if that person deserved it? The person did something wrong. Not that you're just coming along and being a nasty person because you had a bad day, but that person actually did something wrong. So now you want to go to that person and let him have it and let him know that what he did was wrong. Better to throw yourself in a fiery furnace than actually try and rectify that wrong in your mind? Where does it come from? Of course, I think many of us are aware where it comes from, but I want to, this is the basis of the topic, so I would like to start with this with your permission. This is the story of Yehuda, Judah, who after the whole episode of selling Yosef HaSadiq, Joseph, he turns away. There's explanations about what this turning away means because they were blaming him, but that's not the point of what we're doing here. He then finds himself a wife and has three sons, Er, Onan, and Shelah. Now, he finds a wife for the eldest, Er, and the wife is Tamar. Now, Tamar is married to Er. God is unhappy with Er and the way Er is behaving, so God kills Er. So now, logically, she has to be given to the next one, which is Onan, so that there is the concept of Yibum. They can have children together who will actually be considered the child of the eldest, of Er. So the second one, Onan, doesn't like this and does something that the God, that the Holy One, blessed be He, HaKadosh Baruch Hu, finds reprehensible. So God kills him also. So now what happens is, Yehuda, Judah, should be giving Tamar to his third son, Shelah. But he doesn't want to do that. He said, look, the first two sons died. What will happen now if I give my third son to her? So he says to her, you know, hang in there for a while. Wait a little bit. He's young. We'll wait for him to be older, and then you can get married. Now, of course, time passes, and she sees that that's not happening. She sees that she is not being given to Shelah. So what does she do? Now, this is after Yehuda's wife passes away, and I guess he needs comfort. So she goes out, and he thinks that she's one of these ladies who are, should we say, for hire. And she covers her face, which adds to that. And of course, that way he can't recognize who she is. And he says to her, you know, I would be interested. How much? And she says, whatever it is, gedi, which they translate as kid. I don't like that word because people think you're talking about human beings. No, you know, a little goat, a little sheep, whatever. And he says, I don't have my sheep or American Express. I left home without it. I don't have it on me. So what can I do instead? She says, well, you'll give me an erabon. You'll give me some kind of collateral. And what will you give me? A hothemeth, a signet ring, pithilim, which they translate as a bracelet, and the matay, your staff, your cane. And I'll hold these as surety. And then when you have your American Express, you'll come and we'll take care of matters. So he says, okay, of course, she's not to be found again because she went there for a purpose, that she was supposed to have a child and she was prevented because he didn't give her to his son. Okay, 3 months later, as we all know the story, but again, this is the basis of the whole thing. 3 months later, they come to Judah and said, your daughter-in-law has played the harlot. Not only that, she's pregnant from it. And what does he say? Take her out and burn her. That's it. We don't fool around with things like this. Take her out and burn her. So they come together and she says, fine, just one thing, in private, not publicly, I am not going to get up and defend myself and save myself. What she could do, she could say, look, what did I do that's wrong? It's his fault. He was supposed to give me to Shelah. I had to become pregnant. I did the right thing. He was the one who did the wrong thing, and he didn't have to come to me. She could have gone and said, I've got proof. Look, the signet ring, the bracelet, the cane. It's his. You all know it. You're going to throw me in the furnace? No way. Logically, you think she'd do that. She did not. She said, take the signet ring. Take the bracelet and take the cane and show it to him. And say to him, it is from the owner of this purse, of these items, that I am pregnant. Now, she took a very big chance because Judah could have said, I don't know whose they are, burn her. But Judah, being who he was, he said, Sadcha memeni. She was more righteous than I am. She did this because I didn't give her to my son, Shelah. Could easily have gone the other way, and she could have and would have been thrown into the Kibshan Ha'esh, into the furnace. So this is the basis of what our rabbis of blessed memory tell us. Noah lo le'adam. It is better for a person she'yapil asmo le'chibshan ha'esh. He will throw himself into the fire, into the furnace, where al yalbin pene havero berabim, and he will not embarrass his friend in public. The best way to look at this topic is to look at specific cases. And I'm going to try and do that today, look at some cases that I personally am familiar with and stories that I've heard. Now, there is a story that I would like to tell you that is in Abihim Shel Yisrael Ala Torah about Moreno Rabbeinu Acham Yosef Haim Alav HaShalom, the Holy Ben Ish Chai. In fact, I wrote about this. I'm sure many of you here do get the daily A Torah Minute that we put out. And I did write about this, I don't remember when it was, a week, 2 weeks ago, something like that. I just want to speak about it. Chacham Yosef Haim Alav HaShalom, the Holy Ben Ish Chai, was known to be a person of great, how should I put it? He himself was such a special person, such an honorable person, that he was known to give great honor to everybody, honor to all human beings. That was part of his greatness. He would give honor to Talmidei Chachamim, to Torah scholars. He would give honor to people who came collecting money from the land of Israel or wherever. He would give honor to ordinary people. That is who he was. He cared for people. He treated people in an extraordinary manner, with extraordinary kindness. And you actually see that in his works. You know, people sometimes say, oh, but he's strict. He's strict. He's strict when it makes sense to be strict. But I have never seen someone like him when the people would do something that most people would agree was not the perfect thing to do. He would defend them every way possible, because he cared for people. There's a story of a man who came from out of town. He lived, of course, in Baghdad and didn't know the weather of the place. I don't know where he came from. But he came and it was very, very rainy. And he only had the shirt on his back. No coat, no raincoat, no umbrella, no nothing. So the holy Ben Ishai says to him, here, I want to give you some money. He's giving him money to go buy a coat. The man says to the Ben Ishai, no, I don't want the money. I would just like to borrow your coat. A very strange request. You don't go to the Gadol Ador and say, give me your coat. And it was probably a very special coat. Anyway, that's what he said. And he says, I'll get it back to you later. The Ben Ishai had no problem. He goes, he gets him his coat and lends it to him. Now, the day is progressing. He's waiting for the coat to come back. I guess it's still raining. He's waiting for the coat to come back, and it's not coming. It's getting near sunset. He has to go to the synagogue. So he says, okay, maybe I better take my old coat. So he takes his old coat, and he goes to the synagogue. Now, here's the thing. When he walks into the synagogue, what does he see? He sees the man wearing his coat, sitting in his own seat. The seat reserved for the holy Ben Ishai. This man somehow felt, by wearing his coat, which was no doubt an important coat, he thought everyone would think, wow, we've got to give him honor. So of course he can sit in the Ben Ishai's own seat. The truth of the matter is, he wanted to get honor. He wanted to be praised. He maybe thought people would now bow down to the ground in front of him. But in fact, all that happened was the opposite. People scorned him. People laughed at him. Because he had clearly denigrated the holy Ben Ishai. This story, to me, shows how certain people, in their desire to feel important, do things that honestly are humiliating for them, but we cannot comprehend that such a thing would even happen. In truth, he should not even have asked for the Ben Ishai's coat. We see the greatness of the Ben Ishai that he just gave him his coat. The man made a fool of himself, but he probably didn't realize it. The truth of the matter is, whenever a person does something like this that is a little bit arrogant and puts down another person and feels that way he's going to be greater, what happens is the other person becomes greater, the one he was trying to put down, and the person himself is looked down upon by others. This is all part of what our rabbis tell us about hane'elabim ve'enam odin. When you are insulted and you do not insult back, then we're told that you're like the sun when it goes out in its strength. This is the key. When somebody comes to you and puts you down and insults you, and you do not respond, you do not let him have it back, this makes you greater, as we see in the story, and makes the other person much lower. I want to tell you a story that actually happened to me. Not on the same level as the story I just told you, but there's a similarity there, and that's why I would like you to hear about it. A few years ago, we had something, I forget what we were having in the minyan, that was at night. And prayers, and I don't know exactly when it was. But I remember that it was at night, and it was during the week. So it was during the week. My beloved wife of blessed memory drove me there. And as we arrived, I could see from the outside that there was somebody who wasn't from the area, but he came to us once in a while. And this being during the week, he could drive there and come to us. I saw him sitting in my seat at my table. and it was clearly my seat and my table. Now, I didn't know what to do. Baruch Hashem, Rabbanit Ruth was a very wise woman with great understanding. She says, don't say anything. Go there, ask the Gabbaim to get you a different seat and a different table. Thank you. I went in, I asked them, do me a favor. Get me a different seat. Get me a different table. They brought it for me. I sat down, but I said to one of them, I said, you know, it's not nice. You should have told him that this is the rabbi's seat. He says to me, I did. He said to me, I'm also a rabbi. First of all, to imagine that a person would be able to do something like that, to speak like that, is difficult for us to fathom. But what happened again was very, very simple. Till today, every now and again, someone brings it up, but it's not giving the guy any respect. You understand why they bring it up. So a person who does something like that, you must know. You should not respond. You should not react, because you should know they have put themselves down. You don't have to say anything. You don't have to do anything. Their actions, their words have put themselves down in the eyes of others. If you respond, you go down. If you say something back, and you bring yourself to their level. Or it could be in action. It doesn't have to be in words. But if you respond in like, then they will look at you the same way. If you don't do anything, just ignore it, they will know exactly what the facts are, and it's not in favor of the other person. I want to tell you a story. I told you the best way to learn this topic is stories. This is a true story that somebody told me. Up to this point, I'd heard from Yaniv. Yaniv says, we'd like you to come and speak. I said, sure. What topic would you like? We're texting each other. What topic would you like? I don't know. Whatever you want. I said, okay, I don't know. Whatever you want. He said, no, whatever you want. You decide. I said, no. Whatever you want, you decide. We're going back and forth. Tell me, what would you like? Oh, I don't know. Whatever you're happy doing. No, I'm happy doing what you're happy doing. I hear this story from somebody, and I go, Yaniv, this is what I'm talking about. What am I talking about? Insults and responses, being the bigger person. This is the story, and I want to tell it to you. I got your attention now, right? You want to know what the story was that prompted the whole lecture. I got to give you some background. Used to be some years ago, our big topic was telling everybody, don't watch television. Don't have a TV in your house. You don't know what's on TV. You shouldn't have it. You shouldn't listen. Nobody talks about it anymore. I don't know if you've noticed. Nobody talks about it anymore. I remember one of my daughters. She's sitting here today, so I'm not going to call her out, you know. She used to tell me, oh, I hate it when you talk about that in your lectures. So why do you have to keep bringing it up? I don't know. It's an important topic. How come we're not talking about it anymore? It hasn't changed. It's still bad. The answer is, there's something so much worse. That's why. That's when everyone's talking about the internet and the handheld devices and what the kids are having access to and everything else. It's become, and I want you to know, Midrash Ben Ishai was online with midrash.org in 1996. Nobody else was. And I remember, Shlomo, I don't know if you remember, I remember being at the Midrash when we were all there in Rego Park, getting up in 1996, telling people, you don't know how dangerous this is. Nobody was talking about it. I said, there's so much potential for danger. And nobody knew what I was talking about. Now everybody knows. So the question is, what do you do? And there are several organizations, all of us who we've mentioned here today, who are heavily on the internet. We're reaching people, thousands and tens of thousands of people around the world spreading Torah. And a bunch of those, the majority of those, are actually accessing it on these handheld devices, smartphones and things like that. All right, so we're clearly in favor of spreading Torah that way. Not everybody is, but we clearly are. But there have to be very strong protections. That's not the topic of my lecture tonight, but I do want to say that. There have to be strong protections. Some people like filters. I personally have the system where somebody or more than one person in my family has to have full, unfettered, unrestricted access to all my devices, big and small, and all my passwords. There can be nothing hidden from anybody. All right? And one of my daughters in particular is the one who's constantly checking up on me. But they all fiddle with my stuff. I just tell them one thing. I warn them. I scare them. I said, don't you dare ever send an email or a text from my phone or my computer that anyone thinks is coming from me. You got to scare them. You don't know what they're going to do and what they're going to say and what kind of trouble I could get into. So once I scared them with that, I allow them to have unfettered access. All right. Now, there are people, as I was saying, you've been to neighborhoods in Jerusalem probably where there are big signs that basically say in Hebrew, if you have a smartphone, get out of our neighborhood. Now, the story goes like this. This is actually a very recent story that it was told to me. A man came collecting, as you have seen, from Eretz Yisrael, from the land of Israel, collecting money. For what? I have no idea, but he came collecting. He went to a synagogue, and he prayed in that synagogue. Now, you know, some people pray with their smartphones. You don't see too much. On the whole, I find it for Minhan Arbit, there's no problem. For Shacharit, it's a little more complicated, but some people do use it from time to time for Shacharit, and I've talked to somebody about it, and he said the following. He said, especially on days like fast days where there's a lot of turning in the Siddur, he finds it much easier because his program, his app, just has everything in order the way it has to be. He doesn't have to flick back and forth. Okay, fine. So there was a person who was a well-respected member of the community who was using his phone. What he was doing with the phone, I don't know, whether he was praying. I'm not getting into that. But that's my understanding. And there was this man who had come from one of these neighborhoods, apparently, where if you have a cell phone, get out of our neighborhood, who was collecting, but was sitting next to him. And he was watching this guy on his phone throughout the prayer. I was told that after the prayer was over, this man who came collecting, at the top of his voice, started berating this valued member of the community so loudly so that he made sure that the people at the other end of the hall would hear everything he was saying. And apparently the man who he was berating only said one thing. He says, you don't know what I'm doing. But that set him off even more. I couldn't care less what you're doing. I don't care how important what you're doing is. I don't care if your grandmother's dying. I mean, he didn't say that. I'm making that up. But that was the kind of thing that he was going on and saying. And then he added, he says, and I want to tell you something further. He said, if you're praying for anybody, instead of doing them any favors, maybe they're sick and he wants to for a while, maybe somebody's passed away, whatever, he says, instead of helping them, you're sending them down to Gehinnom. You're sending them down to hell. And he's going on at this guy. This guy did not respond, other than what he told him at the beginning, which was, you don't know what I'm doing. He didn't respond at all. All right. What was the net result? The net result was, I'm told, the next day, the whole community was talking about it, or at least a bunch of people. And they were saying, this guy, how dare he? He comes here, he wants to collect money. How dare he behave like this? How, you know, it shows total disrespect. And then one thing led to another about how these guys behave, how this, how that. You know, it just escalated into something astronomical. Who was the one who made a fool of himself? It wasn't the guy who was being berated. It was the one who was doing the berating. And unfortunately, whatever good there was in what he was saying, whatever good there was in what he was saying, got dismissed out of hand by the rest of the people there because of how it was done and the fact that it was done in public. He could just as easily, apparently, you know, there's so much hatred in this person about this whole topic that he had to let it loose, because if he had gone quietly to the guy and just said to him, you know, I don't know what you're doing on your phone, and he would have found out, he would have been quiet. But he said, but you know, if you're I don't know, surfing the internet, which of course, the last thing you want to do while you're praying, It's not the thing to do. It could actually make it worse. And the guy says, well, I'm not doing that. Then they would have been able to end this whole thing amicably. But that's not what happened. So this man then turns around and says, David HaMelech, the man meaning the one who was berated. We know the story of King David and Shimei ben Gera. The whole story where he curses King David and he throws stones at King David and this and that and the other. And David HaMelech, they want to kill him, and David HaMelech says, no, how can you do that? He may be the one doing it, but it came from God. If it came from God, I deserve it. I must have done something, whether in this matter or in a different matter, that I deserve this punishment. So, yes, it's true. The guy is nasty. The guy is saying things and shouldn't be saying things. But if it happened to me, I'm not going to kill him. Or in our cases, we shouldn't try and kill him with our words, because it happened to me for a reason. Maybe it's not in the area in which it happened. Maybe it's in a different area. But maybe there's something about me that I need to make a tikkun. I have to look at myself and see why this thing happened to me. Why did the person insult me? But the fact is this, that it's true that it's from God. But it's also true that the other person did behave in an unacceptable fashion. Our rabbis tell us, Hamalbin Pene Habero Berabim, a person who embarrasses his friend in public, Af al pi sheyesh beyado Torah umasim tovim, even though he's a Torah scholar, he does mitzvot. And he can say, I'm great, I've studied, I've done, I know, I this, I do, all the kinds of things, all these kinds of things. En lo helek le'olam haba. He does not have a portion in the world to come. Hold on. Whenever we hear that expression, we don't take it seriously. Just a minute. Anybody who embarrasses his friend in public does not have a portion in the world to come. That is hopefully where we're going. If you don't have a portion in the world to come, there's no portion for you there. Where are you going? You say, Gehinnom. Our rabbis tell us, Kol hayodim legehinnom olin. Everybody who goes down to hell eventually comes up. You know, that's why we have the concept of reading Kaddish for 11 months, because we say that the sentence, the mishpat, the deen of a rasha, of a wicked person, is yab chodesh begehinnom, is 12 months in Gehinnom. So we don't want to say that the person for whom we are reading Kaddish is a rasha, is wicked, so we stop after 11 months. Because it's 12 months if you're a rasha. There's a difference between Sephardim and Ashkenazim. Ashkenazim stop altogether at 11 months, and then just on the Yarset, on the date, they read again that day. Sephardim stop for a week. There are different customs as to when that week is. Usually it's right when the 11 months happens, but some do it later. But they stop for a week and then continue. Why? Because once you've stopped, you've said the person is not a rasha because I stopped for a week, and therefore it's not a full 12 months. But we give them as much as we can, and we go on another 3 weeks. So in other words, a person, and there are exceptions to the rule, but the basic rule is a person goes down to Gehinnom when a person dies. How long they're there for depends. If they're a Sadiq, they're like this whisk through. Hardly dipped in it. Not even time to get out their camera and take a picture of what it's like down there. They're too fast. They're gone. They're all the way up. Sometimes maybe they're a week, a month, 6 months, up to 11 months. Unless they're Rishaim, then it's 12 months. But eventually, they come out. Kol hayordim legehinam. All those who go down to hell, olin, come out. Go up. Hus mishlosha. Except for three. V'had menayhu, and one of the three, you don't need to hear me say it, do you? Hamalbin pene habero berabim. The one who embarrasses his friend in public. So this guy who's telling this person in the Beit Knesset, go down to Gehinnom, does he know what he was doing? Does he understand the severity of what he said? You know, it's easier to think about this when we have someone else in mind. Him, yeah, right, he doesn't understand. He's going to go down the Gehinnom for saying this. But wait a minute, hold on a minute. How careful must we be not to say something to someone who will embarrass them, which will embarrass them in public? All of a sudden, Hamabin Pene Habero Barabim, Af Al Pi, even though this person has in his hands Torah and Ma'asim Tobim and good deeds, doesn't have a portion in the world to come. Now we understand what it means, doesn't have a portion in the world to come. That is something so severe that I think that we have to be very, very careful never, ever, ever to do that. Is there a way out of it? If a person does do it, yes. And that is, you have to apologize to the person. Is that ever going to happen? Because the person is so sure. When a person embarrasses another person, they're so sure that they're right, and this person deserves to have his nose, you know, rubbed into the dirt, that they will never apologize. And what about this guy? He's gone back to the land of Israel, let's say. Is he ever going to see this guy again to apologize to him? We have to be very, very careful. All right. The problem is, if we were less into this Jew against Jew, and we understood that we were one people, and we understood that we need to love each other, all these cliches that are only cliches in our minds, if they would only become reality and actually mean something to us, then the world would be a little bit different. I want to tell you another story. I came back from India about 2 weeks ago. Has to be 2 weeks because I'm just getting over the jet lag. You're laughing. First of all, there's a 10.5-hour time difference. It's like when it's night, it's day. When it's day here, it's night there. It's like insane. You don't know whether you're coming or going. Secondly, the flight, just sitting on the plane, flying, not the bits before and after, is 16 hours. When I come back, I'm knocked out for 2 weeks solid. Now, I go regularly to India. Why? Because in addition to all the other stuff, I'm also the rabbi, the spiritual leader of what's called the Sir Jacob Sassoon Trust, which have three synagogues under them in India. And I have to go there regularly. Those of you who have ever heard of David Sassoon, many, many years ago, late 18th century, he went from Baghdad to Bombay. He basically built up Bombay. If you go there, it's like the whole history is him. You'd see him if you look him up, David Sassoon. He's my great-great-great-grandfather, and basically just inherited it. And so I have to go there several times a year. Now, I was there on a previous occasion, and I had some dealings with a certain person, and that person met me at one of the synagogues. But this particular synagogue, the downstairs is halls and offices. The next floor is a beautiful synagogue, and then the top floor is the women's gallery. So he had come to see me. He was Indian. He was Indian. Now, India, I was there this time, and there was a professor from Moscow who was there visiting. And he says to me, I can't do the Russian accent, real, real Moscow accent. He tells me, he says, this is the world headquarters of Abodah Zarah, of idolatry. Because they got idols for this, idols for that, idols for that. You know, there are three religions in India. There are a lot of religions, but there are three primary religions. The main one, by far, is Hindus. Then you have the Muslims. And then, much smaller, but you have the Christians, Catholics. But Hinduism is like, it's Abodah Zarah. So this Indian gentleman came to see me in the synagogue, but downstairs in one of the offices. This time he came to see me. He says, you know that other time I saw you at your temple? I said, yeah. He said, I don't understand. There were you prayed there? I said, no, the prayer's upstairs. He says, I couldn't figure it out. He said, there were no pictures or idols. So, we don't have idols, you know. We just don't have idols, you know. You know how for us, it's just weird. You take a piece of paper, you take metal, a stone, and like Abraham Avinu, you know, he says, oh, this big idol broke all the other idols, you know. So, come on, you made this yourself. What are you doing worshiping it? I don't understand it. I had an eye-opener. He couldn't comprehend what I was saying. He says, how can you pray if you don't see the idol in front of you? I'm looking at this guy. Anyway, whatever it is, just to give you a little bit of background, they got an idol for this, an idol for that, an idol for the other. I'm flying to India on this trip. I don't have the luxury of sitting in the front, you know. I sit in the back with all the baggage. No, the baggage is down underneath. But anyway, whatever. This time, unusually, I had an empty seat next to me. And the other side of the empty seat was an elderly Indian gentleman who has been living for many years in America. He's, I don't know where he is, in Oshkosh, Wisconsin or something. Someplace, I don't know where. So he's talking to me. You know, they see this thing on my head. They all want to get into discussions about being Jewish. Most people know you're Jewish. Once I was next to a young Sikh gentleman, and he says to me, oh, you're Muslim. I go, no. I say, I'm Jewish. He says, oh, Jewish. You're very rich. I said, yeah, I'm sitting in the back with you. So, but this guy was a little older. He grew up Jewish. He says, tell me, he says, you also have God, like we say God, you use the word God? I said, yeah, we say God in English, we say God. And then I'm thinking to myself, I better do some Kiddush Hashem here. I said, but you know, we only have one God. He opens his eyes in amazement. He says to me, gosh, we have tons. Truth. But what he said next is what I want to talk to you about. He says, still, you know, this gleam in his eyes, he says, and it makes all kinds of arguments. Apparently, this temple favors this god. That temple goes with that god. And this one is with that idol. And this one is with the other idol. He says, so they're always fighting amongst each other. And I'm sitting there thinking, Rabbono shel Olam, we have one God. And we're fighting with each other. What on earth are we fighting about? I don't get it. It's like you have one father and mother, right? And you have a bunch of kids. The kids don't always agree with each other. I mean, they have little spats and stuff. I'm not talking about that kind of fighting. But heavy-duty fighting, when you hear about siblings fighting, really serious fights, you go, why is this so bad? This is so terrible. But as the Jewish people, we're doing it. Jew against Jew. We got one God. Let me do a little Kiddush Hashem in this room. We got one God. We should stop fighting with each other. We don't have to agree with each other. I agree with you. If people don't think like me, they're wrong. I 100% I'm on board with you. I got it right, they got it wrong. But it doesn't mean I have to hate them and fight them. Okay, they're entitled to their opinion. You know, when they go to Shemayim and they'll be told, you should have done it like Rabbi Menashe, then they'll get it. Fine. But in the meantime, I can get on with them. We have one God. We don't have tons. Baruch Hashem. So I think that's a very big lesson that I think I learned from that guy. And this infighting, you don't know what it does. It can have the effect of turning religious people away from religion. Honestly, I've seen that. People, solid people, born into religious families, because the way people behave towards them, they get turned off. But behaving well and nicely with other Jews can also have the effect of bringing people back. I want to tell you a story that is told by Rabbi Mordechai Eliyahu, alav shalom, the chief rabbi of Israel, Rishon Lision at the time, and about a man who was having trouble making ends meet somewhere in Israel. I don't know where it was. There's some town somewhere in Israel, not one of the main towns. He was having trouble making ends meet. So what did he do? He got smart. He said, I figured out a way that I'm going to make some money. He grew his hair long and only spoke English. Okay, he's only going to speak English. I don't know what kind of accent he had, but he only spoke English. And he made everyone think that he's not Jewish. He was Jewish, Israeli. And they all wanted his services as the Goy Shel Shabbat, the Shabbat Goy. So all the religious homes, when they needed a guy to work for them on Shabbat and stuff, they went to this guy. Hey, he's making out like a bandit. He's making money. He's transgressing Shabbat. But they didn't know. And he didn't care. He's some foreigner, only speaks English, and he's got long hair, and who knows who he was doing work for. He was doing for the families, maybe the rabbis of the town, the yeshivot, everybody. Yeah, this is the, you need a goy for Shabbat, that guy, he's good, he's got good rates, and he's got a good smile, or whatever it is. One day this guy goes to the rabbi of the town, and he says to him, I hope the rabbi was sitting down. He says, I want you to teach me how to make teshuvah. I want to become religious. I hope he was sitting, because if he fell off his chair, it's easier than if you're standing and you fall. It's a much harder fall. He probably was doing work for this rabbi. So the rabbi says to him, when he picks himself up and dusts himself off, he says, listen, there's something here. I'm speechless. He says, speechless. I can't talk. Say it again. He says, I want to be religious. I want you to help me. He says, explain it to me. What's going on? Why do you suddenly want to become religious? He said, well, I was in the yeshiva. I suppose he was turning on the lights and the air conditioning in the yeshiva and doing all kinds of stuff over there. And he says, and I heard them talking. And one person said that a Jew is a Jew is a Jew. Whatever he does, whatever he doesn't do, he remains a Jew. And he said, it did something to me. It did something to me. I guess he felt that he wasn't being rejected, that he was still accepted as being a Jew, that it affected him. And he said, I want to be a religious Jew. If I'm a Jew and a Jew and a Jew, despite what I did and how I fooled the world, if HaKadosh Baruch Hu, the Holy One, blessed be He, considers I'm a Jew, then I really want to be a Jew. I want to do what is required. This is something we have to understand. How we interact with others is critical. It's vital. It can turn people away, but it can bring people back. The rabbis all tell us, the Orchot Tzaddikim, everyone tells us that this embarrassing people is one of the worst things that we can possibly do. And it can take many different shapes and forms. For instance, we're told that if somebody, there's something in their past that they're not happy about, don't bring it up. I actually saw this in action. I saw this in action recently. There was a person speaking, and they were speaking about somebody there, and he, in the middle of his speech, he says about this person, he's trying to give this person honor, but he starts saying, I remember you in your younger days and those things. He didn't say what it was. And the person he was speaking about was sitting there smiling, but I could imagine what was going through his mind. And the worst thing is, since he didn't say what it was, which is a good thing probably, everyone is trying to imagine, what could it have been? What could this guy have been getting up to in his younger days? That he doesn't want to mention me. He says, oh, I remember. Why? What is the need to do it? Does it make you feel that you're above everybody else because you know something they don't? Or do you think that it's something cute and the guy will find it funny? But probably he won't. Let's say that he was, he wasn't religious. And now he is religious. So why are you bringing it up? We care about what he is now. Let's say he was overweight, now he's become very slim, or whatever it is. Whatever it is, Ba'asher Husham, HaKadosh Baruch Hu, looks at us the way we are now. We have to do the same thing. We have to learn from HaKadosh Baruch Hu. We don't start bringing up things in the past that's going to embarrass people. We have to be very, very... The problem is, we sometimes talk before we think. And they say, don't talk more than you have to. Don't talk more than you have to. If you don't talk more than you have to, then you're less likely to say the wrong thing and upset another person. Even if it's said as a joke, it can hurt the other person. So remember, not only must we not embarrass another person, not only must we not, in public, say things because the repercussions are terrible, but that we ourselves should not respond to it. And if we have to respond, remember what our rabbis tell us, ma'ane rach meshib hima, that a soft answer can turn away anger. But if you give them a harsh answer back, you're going to create one almighty explosion. I just want to end with this. It says in the Gemara Brachot, speaking about this ma'anerach, answering a person quietly. It says, ma'anerach, meshib hema, someone who answers quietly turns away anger. Umarbesh shalom imehau, and increases peace with his brothers. Ve'im kerobau, and with those he is close to. Ve'im kol adam, and with everybody. Ve'afilu im nochri bashuk, and even with the non-Jew in the marketplace. Kedei shiyeh ahub lema'ala, so that he will be loved or beloved above in heaven, ve'nehmad limata, and liked down here on earth. Ve'yeh mekubal al ha'beriyot, and that all people will accept him. And then it speaks about this famous case of Rabbi Yohanan ben Zakkai. Amru alav, it said about Rabban Yohanan ben Zakkai, shelo hikdimu adam shalom me'olam, that no person ever wished him before he wished them. Wa'afilu nochri bashuk, not even the non-Jew in the marketplace. We're Jews. We're the ones who have to light the world. We have to lead by example. We should start with our own people, lead ourselves by example in how we behave with our own people. And if they don't behave appropriately with us, we should show them how not to react and how we should react quietly. And above all, let the nations of the world, like I was saying, we have to do our bit of showing them, you know, Kiddush Hashem. Let's show them, because they know we have one God. Let's show them the Kiddush Hashem of how we behave with them and the entire world. And hopefully that Zechut HaKadosh Baruch Hu will take away all this argument and fighting and soon bring us Mashiach Tzidkenu, Amen.